Okay, so we're going to begin. Welcome, everyone. My name is Natalia Brizuela. Can everyone hear me out there? I'm really happy to be here on this small with this small group of people, but knowing that everyone else is out there as we gather today to celebrate Estelle Tarica's new book. I'm the director of the Center for Latin American Studies, and today's event is part of a new series we're having, a class on new work, both scholarship and creative work by faculty who work on Latin America across campus. And we've always been inviting another faculty member and a graduate student to be in conversation with the artist, maker, or scholar. And that will be the shape of today's conversation. Before we begin, I just wanted to send a big shout out to the people that actually make this possible. And those are Julia Bird, Greg Loden, and Janet Wagaman, who are the real people who run the Center for Latin American Studies. And if any of you have ever done anything with the Center for Latin American Studies, I know that you are always probably equally grateful as I am for everything they do for the center and for us as a community at UC Berkeley and beyond. Their commitment is really amazing. So today's event is a conversation on Estelle Tarica's new book, Holocaust Consciousness and Cold War Violence in Latin America. And it will have the following structure. Estelle will give a presentation that will be followed by commentaries from Alejandra Decker and then from Professor Robert Kaufman. I'm going to read a brief bios of them. I'm going to concentrate on Estelle Tarica's bio because she's the star of this afternoon. And so I don't want Rob Kaufman or Alejandra Decker to feel offended, but there are longer bios of them that are available on the class website. It's just because the event is rather short and the book is very rich. So I want to leave as much time for that. So Estelle Tarica is professor of Latin American literatures and cultures in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese and a former chair of the Latin American Studies program at UC Berkeley. She's the author of The Inner Life of Mestizo Nationalism and the recently published book that we'll be having a conversation around today. Her research includes the study of racial ideologies and how these are linked to discourses of cultural decolonization, especially in Mexico, the Andes, and the French Caribbean. Her work is particularly engaged with questions of novelistic form and language as a means to approach the dynamics of modern subjectivity in highly racialized societies. Alejandra Decker is a PhD candidate in Hispanic languages and literatures, focusing on the history of scientific thought in 19th century Latin American literature. And Robert Kaufman is a professor in UC Berkeley's Department of Comparative Literature, where his teaching and research emphasizes 20th and 21st century poetry from Latin America, Germany, France, and Britain. I welcome everyone to send questions through the Q&A function at the bottom of the screen. It will make everyone's life easier if you post your questions there so that they can be shared with our panelists today. But feel free to use the chat for what we all know we now use it for, to keep this lively and share your thoughts and existence out there so we know you're there. So with that, I am going to hand over the screen to Estelle and thank everyone for being here.
Thank you so much, Natalia, and thank you everybody for being here today. I'm honored to see so many people. I see that there are friends and family in the audience. I see colleagues from Berkeley, from Argentina, from Mexico, from the Latin American Jewish Studies Association, and from many other places. And I'm very honored. And thank you also to the Center for Latin American Studies for inviting me to present, and Natalia for the nice introduction, and Natalia, who's an esteemed colleague in Spanish and Portuguese and who's the chair of the center, and to second her recognition of the behind the scenes work of Julia Bird, Janet Wagaman, and Greg Loudon, who organized and produced this event. And also thank you to Alejandra and Rob, who very generously agreed to join in this conversation today. And Alejandra, I know you just finished writing your doctoral exams yesterday, and so that makes it even more special that you made space in your calendar to hold my work and this event. I also owe a debt of gratitude to my editor at SUNY Press, Rebecca Colesworthy, and I realized far too late that I neglected to mention her in the acknowledgements of the book. Rebecca is a consummate professional, and she and her editorial staff did a beautiful job shepherding this project through to completion. And thank you very much. A belated shout out to SUNY Press. So briefly, I want to talk about the book with you. I'm going to share my screen and prepared a few low-tech slides. Let me get that going. Okay, so this book is about how Holocaust memory and history circulate in Latin America, and particularly their impact in shaping how people understand the state violence they experienced during the national security crusades, and counterinsurgency campaigns of the Cold War. How and why did the Nazi genocide of the Jews in Europe become meaningful to Latin American authors and activists during this time? For many Americans, the main connection to the topic has been limited to knowledge about Nazis who fled to Argentina after the war. Didn't all the Nazis go to Argentina? That's the ironic title of a foundational piece by Edna Eisenberg, my late lamented and acerbic colleague in the Latin American Jewish Studies Association, who accomplished pioneering work in bringing our attention to the many other facets of Latin America's awareness of the Holocaust. My focus in the book is on several distinct times and places where we can see Holocaust consciousness at work. One, Argentina during the repressive years of the military dictatorship of the 1970s and early 80s. Two, Argentina during the memory debates of the post-dictatorship period of the 1990s and 2000s. Three, Mexico in the 1970s, after the 1968 Tlatelolco massacre, and during the period when Mexico welcomed thousands of Argentine political exiles. Four, Guatemala around 1992, the 500th anniversary of Columbus's quote unquote discovery of the Americas, and on the eve of the peace accords that would formally bring the 36-year civil war to a close. And five, Guatemala in the late 1990s and in the period surrounding the 2013 trial of General Efrain Rios Montt, two moments of increased debate about whether the crimes committed by the Guatemalan army against Maya villagers constitute a genocide. In each of these scenarios, I draw our attention to a shared language about solidarity, testimony, and liberation that involves a reflection or refraction through the Holocaust. Research for this book involved many gratifying experiences. If I were going to share just one of them with you, it would be the experience of reading Jewish Argentine newspapers, especially the weekly Nueva Presencia. This was one of the only Jewish newspapers to publish continuously during the military dictatorship. I read every single issue from 1977 to 1983, and I sort of fell in love with its left-leaning yet pluralist sensibility, guided by its editor, Hermann Schiller, who was a perennial target of rival right-wing Jewish newspapers. And I learned so much from its pages about the complexities of Argentine Jewish life, about Argentine Jewish approaches to Holocaust memory, and about the globalization of the Holocaust. I also want to highlight some of the material that I touch on in the book in regards to the Guatemalan genocide of the early 1980s. And I examine two fascinating moments of convergence between Holocaust testimony and Maya testimony in post-genocide Guatemala. The first concerns debates around Rigoberta Menchú's 1983 testimonio, I, Rigoberta Menchú, an Indian woman in Guatemala, debates that were provoked in the 1990s by anthropologist David Stoll's accusations that she had fabricated parts of her story. Holocaust testimony became a feature of the ensuing debate when some of the US academics who came to Menchú's defense turned to scholarship about Holocaust survivor testimony to support their arguments and pointed to the parallels between this case and Holocaust denialism. The second moment concerns the partnership inaugurated in 2015 between the Shoah Foundation Institute for Visual History and Education at the University of Southern California and the Guatemalan Forensic Anthropology Foundation. The partnership was designed to produce video testimony by Maya survivors of army massacres in the 1980s. These instances, both of these instances, involve attempts to place Maya voices at the center of national narratives of the past and do so in dialogue with Holocaust survivor testimony. They join an increasingly complex constellation, the Guatemalan testimonies housed in Southern California form part of the larger universe of Holocaust education, and are indeed at least partially a product of it. They join an increasingly complex constellation of genocidal events that are connected to and partially subsumed by a Holocaust template, yet remain separate from it as well. So as you can see, there is a deep historical impetus to this project. My aim is to demonstrate the existence of an established Holocaust consciousness in Latin America and to offer a context for it. And this requires specialized knowledge in two fields, Holocaust studies and Latin American studies, that rarely speak to one another, or when they do, tend to speak past one another. I do hope that the book is a mutually beneficial intervention into these two areas of study. And the book also contains a more speculative vein. They test out the hypothesis that there exists a Latin Americanized Holocaust consciousness, much in the same way that there exists an Americanized Holocaust consciousness. Can we indeed speak of the Latin Americanization of the Holocaust? I also try to understand why comparative and instrumentalized thinking about the Holocaust is so fraught. I consider the cases that I study in this book to be attempts to use the Holocaust to confront Latin American history rather than evade it. And I make a case for why these transpositions are in some sense inevitable, maybe even noble, even if they are sometimes misguided or if there is much that may get lost in the process of translation. And I will leave it to the readers and commenters to decide whether I've treated these thorny questions persuasively or not And really, I thank you all so much for being here to celebrate the book with me. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Estelle, for starting off the conversation and for inviting me to respond to your book and for the book itself. I think it's a book that I didn't know that I needed or that could even exist, but you've brought it into reality. And so thank you for that. Thank you, Natalia, and the class staff for organizing and moderating. And Rob, it's always a pleasure to be in conversation with you.
Alejandra, can you speak up a little bit?
Yeah, of course.
Thank you.
So I wanted to start off by the title and to recognize that just in that title, Holocaust consciousness and Cold War violence in Latin America, it's such an expansive and original scope. As Professor Tarica mentioned, it weaves together the fields of Holocaust studies and Latin American studies. It traces the ways in which a European phenomenon has been connected to post-colonial moments in the global South. And to do this, it brings together an archive that was previously diffused or in separate disciplines, and also in these interesting genres, not just literature, but newspapers, scholarly works, political activism, these sources where these two different periods of violence, you know, the genocide of the Jews during the Second Cold War, or the Second World War, and the state repression in the name of anti-communism in Cold War Latin America are thought in tandem together. Professor Tarica traces the roots, the motivations, and the often complicated afterlives of this intersection, demonstrating how this Holocaust consciousness came about and what dimensions it took in Latin America. As she states in the intro, it's not a given that an awareness of the atrocities committed against European Jews would then be used to inform and intervene in discourses around these events, you know, the Dirty War in 1970s Argentina, 1968 massacre at Tlatelolco in Mexico, and the extermination of Mayan communities in Guatemala. I think what's so important about this book is how Professor Tarica's approach teases out the very, very complex dynamics of this exchange. At one level, Holocaust consciousness was being used as a powerful tool for denouncing state violence in Latin America. But at the same time, the book stresses that the threat of Holocaust denialism haunts all these attempts to turn the Holocaust into an analogy for violence in another time and place. As the book proposes, the references made to the Holocaust in these Latin American contexts were not as concerned with historical accuracy as they were with the political and moral force of the reference. Professor Tarica demonstrates that both Jewish and non-Jewish authors and activists refer to the Holocaust not necessarily to educate a Latin American public about its historical facts, but to underscore the extremity of Cold War violence in Latin America, to make this analogy between what was happening in Europe and what was happening there. So one of the most interesting questions is, what is the consequence of this comparative and analogical form of Holocaust consciousness in Latin America? I think this comparative approach provokes one of the most fundamental and maybe unanswerable or most difficult questions that the book presents. What does it mean, or what is the effect of using an awareness of the Holocaust to speak on violence that happens in a different part of the world, under different social conditions, and in some of these cases to a different degree? So I'm interested in that question, though. What is the ethics of an analogy and of comparing experiences? Should we mobilize an event like the Holocaust as a globalized symbol of indescribable violence? I think the book devotes a lot of thought and discussion to some of the many ways this question was answered and debated in Argentina, Mexico, and Guatemala. For me, one of the most surprising discoveries that Professor Tarica's comparative approach offers is that there was a mutually shaping relationship between Holocaust testimony and Mayan testimony in Guatemala and the United States. So the book draws out how Holocaust consciousness in Guatemala intersected also with an indigenous understanding of the Spanish conquest and colonization as a long and ongoing genocide. This chapter also analyzes how debates on Holocaust testimony came to bear on the reception of Rigoberta Menchú's testimony of the Mayan genocide. But I think what really captivated me about that final chapter was that Professor Tarica argues that Holocaust testimony didn't just come to shape how Latin American thinkers were understanding state violence, but that the Mayan testimonies of Cold War violence began to change the nature of Holocaust memory, making it possibly a more multi-directional exchange. What I admire most about this book, and on a personal level, is what I found very valuable, is that it challenges Jewish studies to engage with what is happening in the global South. And it really evoked the description of the Argentinian Jewish writers having to negotiate their response to the state violence that was playing out before them in Latin America. And that confrontation, I think, is deeply generative. To end, and as someone that is both Mexican and Jewish, I wanted to say that this book has already served as a bridge to kind of begin these discussions with Jewish family members and friends to bring them kind of through a thread to Latin America. And in this sense, looking towards the future, I'm excited to see how this book might contribute to developing a space for a consciousness of violence that extends maybe in the opposite direction. Can we speak of a consciousness of the Mayan genocide in Jewish studies? Is there a future where Europe begins to invoke state violence in Latin America in relation to human rights issues in their own countries? So with that, I'll leave it there. Thanks.
Alejandra, that was so great. And it gives me a chance to just say thanks for the opportunity to work together with Alejandra. And I also want to thank Natalia and Julia and Greg and Janet at CLAS, who, just to echo Natalia, all of them. Natalia didn't include herself, so we get to include her. It's just, it's impossible and non-desirable to imagine where we would be without any of them and all of them. Above all, for the moment, thanks to Estelle for writing this really extraordinary book. There's so much to say about it. My notes feel like they would take me about 5 years for me to even think through how to assimilate them for myself, let alone in 10 minutes for everyone else. I guess I want to start by really emphatically emphasizing all the points Alejandra just made. And I'd add a few, not necessarily in any hierarchy. For those who haven't yet opened the book, Estelle has these amazing agendas she needs to set for herself and does, and then she figures out almost magical ways to coordinate them and show her readers how some of what we might have thought about in connections and in constellations, she's taking much further, and quite a number of other things that we hadn't thought about at all as being in related spheres. She shows us very compellingly why they need to be. Along the way, she kind of masterfully, she sort of modestly says she just needs to summarize about five huge, difficult debates among historians, philosophers, and other thinkers about historical comparison, especially historical comparison of the relatively recent, that is given to us, unfortunately, precisely by the Second World War and its aftermath, the term genocide, what it means to make comparisons between cases, how that relates to ideas of historical comparison in general, and whether that kind of historical comparison in general should be used in such cases of extremity. Then she's also thinking about issues across various international lefts, but issues that also are larger than any self-denominated left that involve public life in general and various communities. So without going as I'd love to into any of those. I'll also say something that when Estelle first began this book a number of years ago, I'm fairly sure that neither she and not any of us who were hearing her plans for the book either thought or hoped that the immediate reception of this book when it came out would have to confront. And there's no exact starting point for this. So I'll pick one, although it's not arbitrary. And it's the idea and fact of, I forget the exact numbers, hundreds or thousands of Klansmen and Nazis and neo-Nazis and those parading with torches in Charlottesville, Virginia, shouting Klan and Nazi and other racist and anti-Semitic slogans, and being referred to as fine people by the then president of the United States in the immediate aftermath of that. That's obviously a few years ago, although it's all too present in the country in which Estelle has published the book. We're also in a situation that I'm guessing Estelle hoped one wouldn't have to imagine, of a war going on as the book appears, in which the country and nation being attacked is being attacked in the name of, quote, denazification by a country incredibly, understandably, and importantly sensitive to all uses of that term, now I mean Russia, whose immediate predecessor, the Soviet Union, lost at least 20 million people during the Nazi invasion of that country during World War II. As numerous historians and other commentators have been pointing out only in the last 2 months, we're in a situation where it's all too clear, it's not the final word, but it's all too clear that the term National Socialist or Nazi or genocide, all of which are being used among others right now as we speak, to justify what it's being used to justify, can mean in the eyes of those wielding it whatever one wants it to mean. And that's an additional situation that Estelle's book, I think without ever having wanted to, has entered into. And I think it's going to be extraordinarily helpful, despite it not having, I think, foreseen that entry point for itself. So in lieu of praising all the other things that I'm dying to spend 5 hours praising it for, I just suggest a couple things that momentarily leave praise or evaluation aside in any way, and just explain why, besides the wonderful readings, incredibly deft summaries of complex material, I think for years to come, Estelle's book is going to help sharpen discussions and even very heated debates among those who more or less perceive themselves on the same side, but very much, as Estelle makes clear, don't agree about not just everything, but many important things that relate. I'm just going to take a couple situations here and maybe focus on Argentina, maybe Chile, and the involvement of discourse between each of those two countries, especially in Estelle's book, Argentina, which is what she concentrates on, and the Nazi genocide during, from let's say 1933 to 45. One of the seemingly modest, but I think very, very thoughtful things Estelle does is clarify at the start what a fair number of commentators about these different materials perhaps don't do through no fault of their own. Estelle clarifies that among her key interests are the uses for activism, solidarity, remembering, and various kinds of honoring, that memories in the countries she's dealing with, the memories, the testimony, the uncovering of fact of what happened, can all participate in. There are other goods, that is, cosas buenas, there are other important values she addresses. Those are the ones that she very purposefully and effectively echoes and sort of sets for herself as not her exclusive areas of focus, but those she'll concentrate on. The reason that's so important is that it has the possibility of allowing to come into relief aspects of the debates among those she takes up, treats, and evaluate. She doesn't limit herself to this, but just for time, I'll pick one of the most important of the figures she mentions. And by important for the moment, I mean in terms of both influence and time devoted in Estelle's own text. And that's the Argentine writer, critic, commentator, Beatriz Sarlo. But Sarlo and what might call those not necessarily exactly aligned with her, but close. So I'm not sure others would accept it, but for the moment, I'll just say Sarlo y los Sarlistas. What Estelle very carefully and thoughtfully demarcates is a difference in valuation in all the countries involved. Those across Europe during the Holocaust and those in Latin America, but for obvious reasons in the chapters that Estelle is thinking about, the focus is on Argentina. And one of the debates is about the actual potential causal effect of the propagation, dissemination, framing, etc., of testimonies of what happened, let's take, during the junta, during the dictadura in Argentina. And one thing that Estelle accomplishes that is maybe almost shockingly not yet evident in the debates and the literature is the possibility of provisionally separating out the effects on the ability to be active, activist, to remember, and the question that those all involve, but that other aspects of modern political and social life would involve, which would be, what does one do not only in the aftermath to remember, but what would be the ways in addition to activism itself to think about political and social institution reconstruction, rebuilding, and strengthening? Those obviously touch one another all the time in political life and political history, but it's quite possible also, not least on the left, for focus to be separated between them. And I think one of the things that the way Estelle approaches this is to see that in the Argentine debate and in ways that has its prehistory and contemporary history in the European aftermaths of each of the countries and regions of Europe that the National Socialist genocide took place in, there are debates that harken back to the initial ways of thinking about resistance before it took state power, to Hitlerism, to Mussolini in Italy, et cetera, but especially in the German case and in the long aftermaths. And at times explicitly and at other times implicitly, one of the things that Estelle's book may do is generate the ability for, let's say, someone like Sarlo to be perceived not so much as rejecting as simply individual or emotional or only affective the value of testimony, but asking in addition or alongside that, what are the ways that knowledge of that which happened, I'm putting into translation the famous locution that Celan gives in his poetry, and that's almost immediately picked up by Adorno for decades now. The ways in which the question of testimony may be crucial, but also quite radically inadequate on its own terms to think about political and social and legal institutions that need to be defended and developed. And that's also what inevitably leads one to think of what it means that Estelle's book appears after Charlottesville and during this war, where in both cases, let alone January 6th and between them, there's clear efforts to say things that may look innocuous, that may have been treated by those resisting the worst, so to speak, because they seem to have become passé, laws, courts, democratic forms. They really are on the consciousness and the worry meter of those like Sarlo thinking about different or related or sometimes not related areas of focus in terms of the materials of those who have survived and what they have to contribute. And all I'll do by ending and then turning it back to Estelle and to open the conversation with Natalia and Alejandra and Estelle is to say that Estelle also begins to give us a way, I think, to see that what we might think of as traditional lines, left, center, and right, but for the moment, I'll just take even within the left. And I'm thinking of the Argentine case again, of someone like Sarlo being seen as someone who left the Maoist past, not herself an armed combatant, but a militante very much in support of groups that had been, but someone coming out of, let's say, a clearly extra-parliamentary leftism and connected to essentially communist formations, old and new, in the Southern Cone. That looks like a very familiar difference where the focus would now be on, let's turn to democratic institutions. I just want to suggest that Estelle helps us go back and encourage us to be comparative. She encourages us to be comparative. So I'm going to be comparative about elsewhere in the Americas and talk about one of the signal instances immediately post-World War II. And it happened to be African-American left very, very close to, but not always in, the American Communist Party. Du Bois, William L. Patterson, Paul Robeson, as the most famous of them, presenting to the United Nations in 1951, the petition, We Charge Genocide. But with both the activist component, but a intensely legalistic, it actually caused controversy with the Communist Party itself about their dedication and argument about the importance of rebuilding, an old term for Du Bois because it comes from Black Reconstruction and the argument that democracy always needs to be reconstructed, but institutions that in some sense, like voting, need to be, according to Du Bois, neutral. They need to be formal and that without them, catastrophe will ensue and that the defense of that formality is crucial. The last thing I just want to say is Estelle's book gives us new ways, I think, to have the dialogue be as intense as it needs to be. Even the vigorous and embattled debate about these issues. And I think she gives us ways to make the debate more precise and to let people know when we think what we're fighting or debating about might not actually be the same thing, in order to help us debate maybe more of what we are differing about. So thank you very much, Estelle. Again, I wish I did have the 5 hours, but instead I feel like I've got 5 years of working with and teaching this book. I can't imagine teaching ever again. So many of the courses that I'm lucky enough to get to teach without the book as part of the syllabus. Gracias mil to you, thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much to Estelle, and thank you to Alejandra and Rob for your interventions as well. I'm a new face on your screen. I'm Julia from the Center for Latin American Studies, and I'm here to transition us to a conversation between our three speakers. And I want to start opening it up to Alejandra and Rob to ask any questions that you have of Estelle, and then Estelle, if you have questions back for them, feel free to respond as well. And after that, I will bring in some questions from the online audience.
I can start. I can kind of start by restating that final question that I ended my talk on and see if you have any thoughts on if this consciousness, you imagine it going in the other direction, if there's some value of, you know, Jewish studies having a better handle of colonial violence and post-colonial violence, if that already exists, or what you see that direction going in. And then my other question is, aside from Mexico, Argentina, and Guatemala, what other countries would you look towards that could kind of complicate or add to the book in Latin America?
Thank you, Alejandra, for those questions, and also for your really lovely comments, and Rob, you too, and bringing Charlottesville and Ukraine to the table. It's sort of, you know, angustiante, you know, and also a little intimidating to think that my work could somehow speak to those events. I'm not quite sure how it could. And Alejandra, in answer to your question, I think that for students of the Holocaust, that there is a lot of potential for turning the gaze to Latin America, to look at Guatemala. Work on comparative genocides is sort of flourishing in sociology and history as well. It may become a little bit legalistic, a little bit arid as a frame. I really like the interface that the Shoah Foundation provides, where you may start out thinking that you're interested in one event or one kind of survivor, and before you know it, you're looking at testimony from another survivor, another event. The danger, which is something that I address in the book, is that it can create a kind of false uniformity, a kind of template that you can sort of slot different events, different voices into. But I do think of this as a very productive and generative way to think globally, to think cross-culturally. It's an avenue that has been established and that we can be sort of exploiting more for our students. A separate question is whether Holocaust scholars of the Holocaust who study events in Europe would ever find it useful to study these events. And I don't know. I've found that I've sometimes have been a fly on the wall at Holocaust conferences, and I'm a bit of an exotic creature. And I think there definitely are scholars who are really interested in thinking the Holocaust in a global perspective, and there are institutions that are promoting that. There's also been a lot of work recently trying to understand Germany's colonial heritage and how it is a kind of prologue, a sort of antechamber to what happened in Germany itself. I'm not sure. I think that's a great question, and I'm really curious to see how the field evolves. I think I've forgotten what your other question was, Alejandra.
I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Thank you.
Estelle, I think maybe the first thing I want to ask you that I found myself thinking about reading the book, I wondered, it surprised me that this was one of the first things I wondered about. I wondered, as you did the work and did the writing, what you found to be your own greatest challenges in pulling all this together and in articulating it, and what about the materials and the problems you found and the problems that you were the one who had to bring into their framing. What about it that maybe surprised you the most?
Thank you for that question, Rob. So one of the challenges of writing this book, and it's taken me forever to even be able to sort of barely articulate it, and I don't think I ever articulated it in the book itself, it's been part of the aftermath, is that I'm sometimes not sure if I'm studying a phenomenon that is outside of me or if I am myself a part of the phenomenon that I'm studying. So is my own perspective a form of Holocaust consciousness in Latin America? And to what extent has that determined what I see, you know, out there? I've really, really tried to make this, to take a certain amount of distance so that I could capture the debates that I was seeing, and so that I could kind of delineate the contours of an object that I sensed was out there, but that has very rarely been identified as such as an object. That was actually most of the work, was being able to bring that object into fuller view. I should say here also that there are scholars, especially in Argentina and now in Mexico as well, who have been working on this, and that the field has dramatically transformed in the past decade. There's just so much more amazing work on related topics coming out of Mexico and Argentina. I think it was a little bit that fear of, is this my Holocaust consciousness that I'm writing about, or am I writing about, you know, these other people's Holocaust consciousness, and trying to keep those separate and not really being able to in a way.
Thanks.
Estelle, are there any questions you would like to ask of Alejandra or Rob? If not, we can open it up.
Well, I think I would like to continue the conversation with them, you know, over coffee and maybe open this up. I mean, I'm so intrigued by the reference to Ukraine, and like I said, sort of worried about it, anxious about it. But Rob, maybe me and you can talk about that offline, and I would, thank you both of you for such amazing comments and reflections.
Thank you. I share that appreciation. All right. Well, we have a bunch of questions from the audience, and I'm going to start with one from Delet Dominguez. In your book, you work with different countries and different literary traditions in Latin America. I'd like to invite you to tell us more about the use of the Holocaust memory in these different contexts and how they might differ.
Right. So maybe this, thank you, Dailet, for that question. I'm remembering what your other question was now, Alejandra, which is what other contexts? And so there are some areas where there are scholars who are working on related topics. One of them is Brazil, which just really cries out for this kind of research. And there's some of the research I know, at least in the field of literary studies, is happening. I know of a young scholar who's working on Colombia, that's also sort of really interesting to think about how questions of genocide and state terror would work in Colombia, where the historical configurations are so different. There are Holocaust institutions that have been operating in El Salvador. That would be another place that I would be particularly interested in looking at. I think in each one of these cases, you get to a place where the comparative frame kind of holds them as a container, but the stories become really specific. The other kind of part of that piece of that reflection is that a little bit of anxiety that the Holocaust frame will be a colonizing frame, and that it will displace other, especially indigenous ways of talking about genocide, and not be so much of a dialogue as a kind of taking over or giving voice to that doesn't serve a sort of truly comparative or cross-cultural understanding. One of the places that I thought I would encounter a lot more of this is Peru. And I didn't, and that doesn't mean it's not there. You know, my research was finite there. So I think that's another sort of question is sort of respecting that this is a very uneven phenomenon. It's not just spread out everywhere in the same way. So that's a long-winded answer to Dailet's question.
Thank you. And that sort of brings us to another question. This is from Marilyn Miller. Within the final question as to whether we can speak of a Latin Americanization of a Holocaust studies or a Holocaust consciousness, is there an implicit tension between uses of these terms and concepts in Latin America and uses of the Holocaust, as with the Menchú case, by scholars in the US and elsewhere, overlaying it on Latin America?
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Marilyn, for that question. So, I mean, where I've gotten the most pushback on the idea of a Latin Americanized Holocaust consciousness is in Latin America. It makes total sense. The training I had in Latin American studies is, you know, itself a Cold War construct that has come to fruition most successfully in the United States. It's not a framework that works as well if you're doing research in Mexico or Argentina. So I decided to go towards Latin Americanization in a very kind of idealistic vein. I think I might have even referenced José Martí in the book. but I think this is really a question that you can answer in many different ways. Yeah, and I respect the pushback I've gotten on my use of it.
We have a question from Sandra Gruner-Domic, who says, thank you for a very timely book when the resurgence of the discussion of the uniqueness of the Holocaust in Europe is going on. Do you think Eurocentrism has hindered a deeper analogy before?
Hmm. Thank you, Sandra, for that question. It's true. I think it was last year, it was either last year or the year before, that two Polish historians find themselves threatened and censored for providing a narrative of Polish involvement in the Holocaust that goes against nationalist ideas that are dominant right now. I don't know what to make of this moment. I think maybe 10 years ago, I was really secure that we all kind of sort of know what we mean by the Holocaust, that it's not, that Holocaust denialism is really kind of floating or drifting down into the dustbin of history. That's not the case at all. The opposite has happened. I think definitely some of the Latin American debates maybe would be very fruitfully brought into dialogue with things that are happening in Europe in terms of how to address it. So yeah. Thank you for that.
Yeah. The next question comes from Alfonso Fierro, who says, "The book sounds wonderful. I wanted to ask if you could briefly dwell on how Mexican authors like Jose Emilio Pacheco fit into this project as a whole."
Thank you, Alfonso. So Pacheco has the honor, the dubious honor of being the only novel to have made, to have remained in this final iteration of the book. A few other novels turned into article, my analysis of them kind of got taken, I took them out of the book and turned them into articles. But Pacheco's book really stayed with me. This is a book that he, a novel that he wrote in 1967, Morirás Lejos. Pacheco, who is a Mexican poet and novelist, he was a reviser. He revised everything he wrote, and this novel was no exception. He revised it 10 years later. It came out again in 1977. Essentially the same, and yet practically every sentence between the two versions had undergone some kind of change. And it's a book that is about the persecution of the Jews, the millennial persecution of the Jews. And it has a lot of material related, and particular to the Shoah. And what I discovered, the more research I did on the novel, the more I looked at the changes between the two versions, the more I understood Pacheco's intellectual history, the role of 1968, not just the Tlatelolco massacre and the student movement in Mexico, but also kind of global student movements, because Pacheco was living abroad. He was visiting friends, spent a lot of time in Italy and in England at that time. The more it seemed as if this novel was a kind of repository or sort of complex archive of the moment. He uses a lot of documentary sources. He doesn't cite them, but if you've read the documents that he's referring to, you know that it's a lot of the testimony, a lot of the material he uses to describe the death camps comes from testimony by Jewish victims at perpetrator trials in the 1960s. So I couldn't let this novel go, even though it became the only novel that I really address in the book, just because it is just riven by all of these historical moments. And it really allows one to track what happens between 67 and 77 that would change the meaning of Holocaust testimony in Mexico. And what are the things that happen? One is the 68 massacre, the censorship that comes from that after that massacre that makes it very difficult to talk about the Tlatelolco massacre in the media. This has the paradoxical effect of endowing testimony with a political force that it may not have had before. Then a few years later, you see the arrival of Argentine political exiles who are also steeped in this context where testifying about what is happening is almost a matter of life and death. And all of that becomes sort of interwoven into a novel that has on the face of it nothing to do with Latin America. It's just about Jewish persecution in Europe. So I really recommend this book if you like metafictional novels. It's a very powerful book. I think it was reissued recently. Pacheco died a few years ago. It was a very premature, untimely passing. And I hope more people go back to reading this book. So thank you, Alfonso, for giving me the chance to praise it.
Thank you. And thanks for the book recommendation as well. The next question comes from Amy Kerner, who asks, in the cases you look at in the book, how important are the respective histories of Jewish immigration to the ways that Holocaust discourse gets linked to the Cold War violence? She's especially interested in the Argentine case. Thank you. And she's looking forward to reading the book.
Thank you, Amy. Thank you for your question and for being here. So that's a great question. Here again, you see sort of a very uneven comparative field. There are, in the 60s and early 70s, there were 250,000 Argentine Jews, and there were 900 Guatemalan Jews, as far as we can tell. So, I mean, that's a huge difference. So the fact that Argentina is, you know, a world center of Yiddish culture, that Argentine Jews play such a fundamental role across the 20th century in all areas of intellectual and political life, that they have their own complex assimilationist history, their own very varied relationship to national liberation movements. All of that makes the Argentine Jewish archive an especially rich place to think about the Holocaust. And in fact, it's so rich that you could easily just write books about that. So in that sense, right, the immigration history is sort of determinative. But I think there's something about the orientation of Argentine Jewish reflections on the Holocaust that's, you know, it's not just a numerical, it's not just that there are a lot of Argentine Jews who have written a lot, it's the way they approach it. And it's so different, for example, from the trajectory of US Jews, their relationship to Israel, their relationship to Yiddish, their relationship to the left, has led to a much more integrative and comparative approach to the Holocaust, at least historically, that may be changing also now, than we find in the United States. And I think the question of Guatemalan Jews is one that I still have so much to learn. Guatemalan Jews tend sort of, I could make a generalization, which is that the community tends to be a right-wing community, and so much more allied with the forces in Guatemala that deny genocide, the genocide in Guatemala.
Thank you. And we have one last question, which comes from Alejandro Munera, who says, thank you, Estelle, for the presentation. I'm looking forward to reading the book. I'm interested in the same period, late 70s and early 80s, when a new consciousness about state violence emerges in Latin America. I was wondering if your case for Latin Americanization of the Holocaust could be useful to think about the concentration camps in Cuba during the 1960s, which were used to house homosexuals and religious groups. In other words, could Holocaust consciousness intervene in debates about state violence in other similar contexts in Latin America?
Thank you, Alejandro. That's a fascinating question. I have this idea that concentration camps sort of originated in Cuba, either in Cupa or in South Africa during the Boer War. But basically, I'm trying to remember the source for this idea, that they're not a German and World War II invention. So I think kind of tracing out an alternate history with the camps that were used to punish. Thank you, Dailet. I see that. Yes, in Cuba in the late 19th century, right. So tracing out an alternate history where that becomes a part of our understanding of where a concentration camp comes from, and then its different iterations across Cuban history. I have not read enough about those camps in the 60s and 70s in Cuba to know the extent to which the people who experienced them or wrote about them were referencing the Holocaust. I think that sounds like a really fascinating proposition. So yeah, thank you for suggesting that. But I will let you do that though.
Great, good plan. I want to open it up to Alejandra and Rob one last time, if you have any last comments, or you have just a couple more minutes. I didn't warn them about that, so they're processing. Go ahead, Alejandra.
I think I just want to bring up that last, the Las Cartas que no llegaron that you end the book with. And maybe just to tell us, since people have not read it, and it was such a moving scene, like to the point it gives you kind of chills when you read it, especially because the buildup to that scene is the entire book, and why you put that at the end, and
So Alejandra is referring to a novel memoir by an Uruguayan. Mostly a playwright who became also a poet, a novelist, Mauricio Rosenkopf, who was a Tupamaru militant, imprisoned for 11 years. And when he came out a few years later, he wrote this novel memoir where he interweaves his experience of the camp where he was mostly in solitary confinement and repeatedly tortured, with his father's experience of losing all of his relatives back in Poland in the 30s and 40s. And I had thought that this novel would be a centerpiece of my book, but one thing that happened is that the first time I presented on it, I started crying in public, and I had to stop. And this has happened a couple of times as I've presented material from this project, and it's a little bit of a, it's hard to be a scholar who breaks down into tears while you're giving a presentation. So I've used it now more as a touchstone than as a sort of object of analysis. Because it is such a powerful meditation on almost the perplexity of how the Holocaust could resonate for a Tupamaru who grew up in a Yiddish-speaking household but had no Jewish, institutional Jewish affiliation, who was completely devoted to the cause of national liberation, armed national liberation, and who goes back to a scene from the 40s when a couple, two Auschwitz survivors arrive on the family's doorstep with news about their perished relatives. And all I can say, Alejandra, is that I was really very relieved that I could find room for this book, for Rosenkopf's book in mine, even without devoting a whole chapter to it, because it was one of the first books that I was drawn to for the project. So, and I really recommend this book too. It's been translated into English, The Letters That Never Arrived. So,
thank you. Maybe we should leave it at that. I think that's a powerful way to end this conversation. And I want to call up one comment from the chat, which says, please make this idea of a Tarica Kaufman offline chat over coffee an online one, so we can all continue this conversation and keep learning from both of you. So I want to give a big thanks to Estelle and also to Alejandra and Rob. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts and congratulations on this book.
Thank you, Julia. Thank you, everybody. Alejandra, Rob, it was really amazing to be in conversation with you, and I so appreciate your attention to the work.
Felicitaciones en el libro, por el libro, Estelle. Gracias por hacerlo.
Thank you so much. It was great to be here.
Thank you.